and minister to my need. Because he was longing for you all and was distressed because you had heard that he was sick. For indeed he was sick to the point of death, but God had mercy on him, and not on him only, but also on me, that I would not have sorrow upon sorrow. Therefore I have sent him all the more eagerly so that when you see him again, you may rejoice and I may be less concerned about you. Receive him then in the Lord with all joy and hold men like him in high regard, because he came close to death for the work of Christ, risking his life to complete what was deficient in your service to me. Now, Epaphroditus, he was a Greek, wasn't Jewish, right? His name means one devoted to Epaphrodite, the goddess of love and beauty. Let me stop there. Let's look at Timothy. We got Timothy. Timothy lived his life for the Lord. Probably saved at an early age, and we can see that later on. If you look in 2 Timothy chapter 1, verse 5, I think, it says that his mother and his grandmother were believers, and that faith was passed to him. He lived, and they nurtured him, and they taught him the things of the Lord, and he lived for the Lord all of his life. Now we got Epaphroditus. This guy's a Greek. His parents, by his very name, must have dedicated him to Epaphrodite. They gave him a name as one devoted to Epaphrodite, a false god, a Greek god. So we got one who was a believer from almost all of his life to one who wasn't. We got two different scenarios here, two different guys. Now he's in Christ. Now look at what Paul calls him. Paul calls him a brother. Paul calls him a fellow worker. Paul calls him a fellow soldier. Paul calls him a messenger and minister. And then ultimately, from what we understand, Paul did this. He took the letter and he says, Epaphroditus, go and take it. Take it to Philippi and give it to him. He trusted him to take the letter. Thought you need that. And give it to him and deliver the letter, because he knew why. Epaphroditus was faithful. He had a changed life. This guy was a life that was not a believer, and somewhere during the time, okay, somewhere in Philippi, he gets saved. He's one of the converts. He gives his life to Christ. He wasn't always saved, okay, for lack of a better term. I got a friend named Dale. And Dale was raised in the church. I was not raised in the church. And I always kidded Dale that he was born saved, because he lived his life as a believer all of his life. And he still is. He's a pastor in Alabama. And I used to kid him all the time, he's born saved. Okay? I wasn't in that way. You can't be born saved. Okay? Y'all understand that, right? Okay, good. All right. You can be born saved. Wow, cool. Was I born saved? I don't know. Was I born saved? I asked my mom, was I born saved? No. Okay. But Epaphroditus, somewhere along the line, gives his heart to Christ. He's got a changed life. He didn't have a Christian family. He didn't have a godly heritage. Somewhere along in his life, probably later in his life, he gave his life to Christ. He heard the gospel and gave his life to Christ. So Timothy lived his life for the Lord, born into a Christian family in some way, at least with his mother. But his mother nurtured him. Epaphroditus wasn't. Now he had a changed life. Epaphroditus also had a committed life. It says he was longing for the church. He wanted, because he was concerned, because he got sick. And he knew, and somehow the church must have understood that he was sick. Now you're going, where's all this going to go? Hang on. He was sick, and the church knew it, and he didn't want the church upset. How many of us ever think about getting the church not upset? You ever notice? Think about it. Is it part of our makeup and part of our love for the body of Christ to make sure that it's not upset and we worry about it? And I don't mean worry in a bad negative sense. No, we don't, because nowadays there's individualism. It's all about me. But Epaphroditus was so concerned because he didn't want the church to be overly worried that he was sick. He wanted to understand, I'm okay. God healed me. God did something. I don't want you guys upset and thinking about that. And so he had a committed life. It says he was sick to the point of death. Why? For the work of Christ. You know what it was? Look at the very last verse. And it says that Paul said to him, he said he took care of what was deficient of what they sent to Paul, meaning this. The church sent some support. It sent some support to Paul. And it was probably, most likely, from what we understand, financial support. But when it got there, and Epaphroditus gave it to Paul, it really wasn't going to be enough to sustain Paul because Paul's in prison. He's in what is called, he was like in a house arrest during this time. He had a soldier with him, but he had a place and he could work to a point, but it wasn't enough to sustain him. So Epaphroditus came into town, saw that, and he went like this, I'll take care of the rest. So he went out and started working to give the rest of it to build up the support for Paul that was lacking. And he got sick doing it. He worked himself to sickness because he loved Paul. And he knew the church, that was all they could give. So he made it up himself by working. And he worked and he got sick to the point of death. And that just overwhelmed Paul. This is a man that loved the church and loved believers. His life was committed to them. And then he had another thing. He had a commended life. He was committed, he was changed, and he was commended. Look what he says. Look at verse 29. Paul just commends him. Look at this. Receive him then in the Lord with all what? Joy. Hold men like him in what? High regard. The word receive means this, to accept. And it's not just, yeah, here I'll use, because he's on the front row today. Stand up. This is how most of us receive each other. Hey, how you doing? You ever notice that? You see Sunday morning when you come in, people go, hey, hey. Stand up, don't move. You ready for this? I'm not going to hit you. This is what it means. Yeah, buddy. Oh, God, thank you. Oh, you're healing hands. He's big as a mountain. But that's what it means. It means to receive in such a way of an absolute embrace. It's not the standard like we do most of the time. We're just, hey, how you doing? It means to totally embrace them. And you do it, he said, with joy. Now look, he says, hold men like them in high regard. Look at this. This is unbelievable. The word high regard means to honor, esteem, means to put a great price upon them. It means to hold them dear. Why? Because this man, listen to me, men, this man came into the faith late in life. And he was radically saved. He was a working man. He wasn't a minister. He wasn't a pastor. He wasn't anything like that. Timothy was a pastor. Epaphroditus was not a pastor, but Epaphroditus was doing a similar work that Timothy did. And Timothy was commended, but all of a sudden Paul says, take this guy, this guy who works hard, worked himself to death to help me, and hold him in such high honor because of what he did for the church. See, a lot of times we think as men, and I never really thought this because God called me to the ministry very early after I got saved. But even before that, it wasn't about becoming a preacher. I just loved Christ and I loved the church. I still love the church with all of its blemishes and poo-poo and all the stuff it does. It's an imperfect bride. We're an imperfect bride. We sheep bite each other. We do. But I still love the church because you know why? Epaphroditus and Timothy and Paul, they all saw what the church was to be. This is what the church is. And they gave their lives, whether they were a working man or whether they were a pastor, to further the church, to make it what it's supposed to be. They gave their life and they gave everything they had to that point. That's what it was about. Now, why did they do it? Go to the next slide. The lives and hearts of Timothy and Epaphroditus reflect what the heart and life of every believer should be, that of absolute devotion to Christ and his church. Let me tell you something. In a minute, I'm going to play a song. I want you to read it, and the words are up. It's a YouTube thing. And hopefully we'll get past the commercial. You know how they put those commercials on it? Hi, Geico. No. Walk with me for a minute. Think about it. Think in a picture now. Think. Let your TV get turned on in your head and follow me on this. Jesus is at the beginning of his ministry. And he's walking along the shore. And James and John and Peter are there. He's standing there looking at him. And from the time of their birth, God had called them to be his. Jesus, being the Son of God, being God in the flesh, knew it. And he knew that those three were going to be part of the 12. And they're out there, these fishermen. You know, it's like Deadliest Catch guys. Think about it. Nasty. Foul-mouthed, stinky, you know, a fish. Ugh. And they're standing there and they're washing their nets, cleaning them up. And Jesus stops and he looks at them. And they heard about him already. You're just standing. Can you imagine somebody just standing there staring at you? Nowadays they get arrested for stalking. But I think he stood there for a little bit and watched them. And they're going, weird rabbi. He's looking at him. He says, hey, follow me. And all of a sudden, now this is how I see it, okay? And I think it probably close. But something at that moment happened in their heart. The Spirit of God went click. And they're standing there and they go, yes, follow me. And they understood what follow me meant. Because in the Greek it means to follow and become like me while we're on the way. So they knew what that meant. It says, and they left everything, it says in the scriptures, in Luke chapter 5, I believe. Yeah, 5. Verse 11 says, they left everything. They just dropped it. And they started walking with him. Why? For the sake of the call. Because God called them. And for all that call meant, they knew what it meant, everything. They didn't have a clue of what was going to happen, but they knew what it meant. We had to leave everything. When he called Matthew Levi, he was at the tax collector's booth. It says, what did he do? Jesus, now this is how I see this one, okay? Jesus is walking in one of the gates, and usually before he got to the gate, from what I understand, the tax collector sat there, and they were the most evil men. That they were hated by their own people. Because they had a certain amount that they had to give to Rome, and then they could collect anything else they wanted. And they would tax each hoof on your animal, each wheel. It depended on the day and what kind of mood they were in. So here's Matthew sitting at his table. Jesus walks in, and he sees Matthew, and he stares at him for a minute. Matthew knew of him. And then Jesus walks over and he leans on the table. This is my ministerial enhancements. Leans on the table and he looks at Matthew. He says, follow me. And then he turns around and he starts walking. And Matthew's heart just got twisted. He just got called. And it says he gets up. He leaves everything. And he follows Jesus. The call of God was called. He called Timothy from birth. He called Epaphroditus from birth. They got saved at different times in their life, but the call was there. One was into, like, what we would call full-time ministry. The other one was just a minister in his everyday life. Where's your call? Man, what did God call you to do? I've been a preacher. I've been a phone man. I've been a roofer. I was a truck driver. I was an electrician, not a very good one. What else did I do? Ran Kroger's fuel center. I've done all kinds of things. But all through it, it didn't matter. And I'm not bragging about myself. I'm trying to explain something. It didn't matter where I was, because whether I was ministering, a minister, ordained or not, my life was to share Christ with everyone that I could meet. At the conference, we were going out one day, and Becky and Denise and Rick had already taken off, and I was doing something, and, you know, like the three of them, they were always walking about this fast. That's the way I used to walk. I'm just looking around now. So I'm walking out, and the little hostess girl in this place, it was called The Brew. And so it was right next to the where we were staying, and it had food basically Denise could eat because she's got gluten-free stuff. And I'm walking out, and she catches my eye, not in a bad way. She's like, have a good day. And I went, I said, but let me ask you a question. I said, I'm a pastor, and it's okay. I'm not going to embarrass you. I said, can I pray for you? She goes, really? I went, yeah. She goes, you want to pray for me? I went, yeah. So what can I pray for you about? Everything. And she was absolutely sincere. And I went, you got it. I want to pray for you right now. I won't embarrass you. She goes, okay. I said, can I put my hand on your shoulder like this? She goes, sure. And I put my hand on, she put her hand on my shoulder, and we're standing. And it's so cool, because every time I want to do that, so far, God always blocks people from coming around. I get the time. He gives it to me. He's like, yeah. And so I, and this is not a brag. It was just, these things are so wonderful. These are memories and things that God will use in my life years later. So I started praying for her, and I just asked God to bless her and to be in every area of her life. And to, you know, and she did tell me she was in school too. And I had God to bless her school, to bless her career, what you lead her. And I just prayed this. It wasn't long. It was maybe 20 seconds. And I said, in Jesus' name, amen. And she goes, thank you. And she gives me this hug, and I'm going, you're welcome. And she goes, no one's ever done that. And I went, someone just did. Just, and her little eyes, she's a little teeny thing. Her little eyes are all welled up. She goes, thank you. I said, you're welcome. And as soon as I walked away, somebody came in the front door. And I'm walking, I'm going, yeah, that was so cool, man. You know? Why? Because it's the call. It's the call. You ready, Henry? It's the call. Listen to this song.
Said, come follow me, and they came.
So will you abandon it? It's not about the latest cause that the church is pushing. It's not about justice. It's not about the homeless. Don't get me wrong. It's not about these things. It's about Jesus. Where do you stand with Jesus? He issued the call. From the moment you were born, that call was on your life. Where do you stand? Men, where do you stand? Are you standing as a man that loves God and leading your family, even though in your imperfection, are you leading your family to the call? Are you doing that? Are you leading your friends and your coworkers? Do they know that you're a believer? When I was working as a telephone man, they knew I was a Christian before they ever knew that I was a minister. And they used to do everything they could to get me to stumble. They'd tape pornographic pictures up on my cubicle when I would come in. They would stick them in my truck. They would get the key and stick it in my truck, my work truck. They would talk filthy around me. They called me the FNG. I won't even tell you what that meant. They would do that, and they would just bombard me. One of them came up to me and they says, "Doesn't this bother you?" I said, "No, bring it on." But it was really funny. I was getting ready to feed back. When they needed something, they would find my position on the GPS and they would come to where I was working when nobody else was around, like Nicodemus. And they would go, "You're not going to tell anybody I'm here, right?" "No. Will you pray for me?" I can't tell you how many times that happened. And it wasn't because I was a preacher, it was because they knew that I was a believer. And that's what it comes down to. And I know I preach this every week, and I'm going to preach it every week. Because that's what it's about. Are you called of God? Look at this. If Christ is my life and my attitude, then my life and attitude will reflect the call and character of Christ. We're going to do something. Men, I want us to pray. I want the ladies to pray over you today. I'm going to ask you, as it says in 1 Corinthians chapter 16, it says, I'm going to ask you to act like men this morning. If that ticks you off, good. I was trying awful hard. I'm going to ask you to get up and come down here, and we're going to just crowd around each other. And then women, I want you to come and make a circle around the men. And this is what I'm going to do. Ladies, we want to hear your prayers. If God gives you a word for the men, now come on, man, let's go. If God gives you a word for the men, I want you to say it. It's not a time to put your agenda in it. It's a time to pray. Okay? All the men, young men too. Boys that shave. No, guys. Huddle. Come on. Right here. Come on. Huddle. I'll get in there in a minute, but you guys huddle up. Okay? Now, ladies, who wants to be first? Just turn the mic on if you would, the handheld. Handheld mic, please. Handheld mic, please. Faith, turn the mic on for me, please.
Father, we thank you for each man here. Thank you that you've made each one of them a man. Thank you for the great privilege that you give them to serve you. in their manhood. Please show each individual here, each man here, your call on his life, your specific call for him, that he may know where to set his feet each day, where to head, how to hear your voice, how to know what you have for him to do. Thank you for your gifts, your provision, and your call. In Jesus, amen.
Stay right there, man. Stay right there.
While we're standing here, the word that came to my mind that God gave me was just love. Don't be afraid to show the love of Christ. Don't be afraid to show your love to your wife and your children.
Yes.
And just whoever crossed your path. If God, you know, tells you to love on them, then listen to his call.
Yes.
And love on those people. It's all about love.
Father God, we thank you for the men in our lives. We acknowledge that you have placed men here in our church family, in our home families, to represent you, to represent provision and protection and identity. Please show them that you are their provider, that you give them identity, that you protect them so that they can lead, so they can be the men that you've called them to be, no matter what their age is, how long they've walked with you, what their family status is, what their income level is.
Yes.
You have a calling for them.
Yes.
Give them ears to hear. Give them the ability to know what is true and what is not from you, so that they will be attuned, they will be able to quickly respond and follow. You say that your people will know you. They will recognize your voice.
Yes.
Give our men here that measure, that blessing. You have a full storehouse for them. Open it up. Dump it out into their laps right now, so that when they leave this place, they feel and experience and know and see that you have come to their heart, that they can know that their heart is your heart. We bless them, all the women here, bless our men. We give them the authority that they deserve.
Yes.
And we stand beside them and partner with them.
Yes, Lord.
Thank you, Jesus.
So my former rabbi used to say, God doesn't call the equipped, he equips the called.
Yes,
and I really feel like God is saying, just like what Pastor Ron said, he's called each and every one of you in your own personal lives, whether you're a working man or you're a pastor, he's called you. And so he doesn't call you because you're already equipped. He equips you because you're already called.
Amen. Father, we pray for these men. And Lord, I ask in Jesus' name, as I pray this over myself also, that, Lord, we'll be men of valor. We'll be men that do great exploits for the kingdom. That will be strong in the Lord and the power of his might. That will stand courageous and be full of your courage, O God. Lord, I pray for us as men that we will be full of your Spirit, Holy Spirit, and fill us up. And each morning remind us to ask for a fresh infilling, Lord. I pray for these men and myself that, Lord, will lead our families with godly character, concerned about them and our relationship with you above all things. Lord, I pray that we will love our wives as you love the church, with that same sacrifice. Lord, I pray that these men will be like Epaphroditus, who served the church, who served the people to the point of exhaustion, to the point, Lord, that almost to death, that we will give our lives for the furtherance of the gospel of Jesus Christ. I pray that, Father, we'll be strong in you, that we'll stand up like men. We will not let the world take away our manhood or feminize our manhood, but be proud that we're men. Not macho, but men. That, Father, will be as gentle as a dove, but as strong as a lion. Father, may you be our focus. May we fix our eyes upon you, the author and perfecter of our faith, who for the joy set before you endured the cross, despising the shame, and then sat down at the right hand of the Father. So, Father, may we endure what the world throws at us, despising the shame of being a believer, and stand for being a believer, because someday we will sit next to you. So, Father, give us endurance. Give us perseverance. May our hearts be that of 1 Corinthians 13. And may our walk be that of Ephesians chapter 6. Strong in the battle. And when the smoke and the dust and the gore of the battle settles, we will be standing, because we know that we fight from victory, not for victory. Thank you for these men. It's an honor to stand with them. In Jesus' name, amen. Amen. Now, guys, regard one another. You know what I mean by that? Give each other a hug. You give a grunt, too, like, ah. Before we go, let's sing Cornerstone. I want to sing this song. Okay?
Christ alone, Cornerstone.
Sing it, man.
Weak made strong in the Savior's love.
Sing it out. Let's sing it. Put our hands in the air if you're comfortable doing it. And tell the Lord, Happy Father's Day. Happy Father's Day, Father. Thank you that we are your children and that you're our daddy. And we bless you in Jesus' name. Amen. Go in peace, my friends.